have the Word of God for our lives. Cover me, I pray, with your Spirit, Lord. Help me to preach your Word. In Christ's name, I pray. Amen. I want to talk about testing our spirits, encouraging the second generation church, and about more grace than grace. Now you know my 3 points, and I can sit down. Testing our spirit. Have you taken your temperature recently in regard to where you are spiritually? Oh my, that's a dangerous question, is it not? Have you kind of looked at yourself and tried to understand how you are in terms of your spiritual life? We did that as a church a couple of years ago. We took that natural church development test. Some of you were involved in that. We filled out a form and we put all the results together. And we looked at some of the weaknesses and the strengths of our church as a result of that survey. And you, as a result of what you wrote down, said that perhaps one of our weaker areas in Grace Methodist Church was our passionate spirituality. We didn't have quite enough of it. Oh my goodness. And ever since then, we've been obsessing around that. Well, not really obsessing, have we, Jen? It sometimes has been less than front and center to our agenda. But in the next couple of years, we might want to relook at that and see where we are at this point once again. Are we a congregation, and are you individually someone that looks at a half-empty glass or a half-full glass? That's one way I have of thinking about it. Are we optimistic? Are we pessimistic? Do we feel bad about our situations and bad about our institution and our church? It's not the same as it was 45 years ago. Clearly, Reverend Sartorio packed the seats a little bit more than we do now, but we're still alive and doing quite well, thank you very much. We not always look to the past, we look to the future. And that's important. By the waters of Babylon, they sat down and remembered the days when they were not in captivity, but were in Jerusalem. How can we sing a song of God and the Lord in the midst of captivity? That's what that psalm mentioned. That's what that psalm is all about. There's several versions of that. How many of you know I think Bob Marley used to sing By the Waters of Babylon, and it's a great song, and it kind of gets you right in your heart and makes you want to, you know, have an understanding of how we can and have a half cup that's not full, how we can feel bad about ourselves, oppressed and depressed and in need of increasing our faith. I was a week or so ago at a greeting party for a new pastor over at St. Mark's. He's someone, I think I mentioned this before, that I've known for 30 years, but as he came into that church, he preached a little sermon and said, I was not ordained to serve a failing church. And so people of St. Mark's, who I am your new pastor for, expect me to make a lot of changes, to raise the roof rafters, to encourage you, church at St. Mark's, to become a very successful church. We need to be reminded of that from time to time. We need to encourage the present generation with that kind of renewal of the Spirit. We need to invoke the Spirit of the past, but we need to more especially invoke the power of God in what we do right here and now to encourage our generation in the church. Even if we have a bit of faith as small as a mustard seed, according to Luke, that's going to be enough to raise up the saints and make a wonderful and successful new attempt at renewing our faith. The early church keep on keeping on, to think of their glasses half full and not half empty, to see the possibilities of faith without any shame, not being timid, not being courageless, but to be able to talk with others and to live their faith in such a way that the word of the living God would spread and be exciting and would be in that place where they were worshiping. And so the question comes down to us. Have we rekindled the gift of God's Spirit? Do we have passionate spirituality in our midst at Grace Church? Can we continue to make sure that we lift up the Lord in all that we do? Can we be good, but can we even do more than being good? Because this congregation does have a lot of passion and spirituality. This congregation has a lot of good things going for it. But can we grow our seed and have it fulfill itself even more? Can we go to the next level? Can excellence in serving the Lord become our byword? Can we increase our faith as the disciples and the apostles asked Jesus? Increase our faith, they asked. And Jesus said, if you just have that much, that little tiny bit like a mustard seed, you can be fulfilled and be fulfilling. You know, that last part of the Timothy passage is what we sang on our way in here. But I know whom I believe in and am persuaded that he is able to keep that which I have committed unto him against that day. I'm going to be talking in the coming weeks, months, about how to rethink church a bit, how to think about what we need to do here at Grace to not only keep the grace in grace, but to even increase the grace in grace. One of the tools for that is some of the success stories of churches across the country, and I want to indulge you just a moment more as I end up by reading you something from the circuit rider that came out this August and September. It's a national magazine for pastors and church leadership. And they are talking about how to reinvigorate the church. And here's this article by Martin Feinman, who is a pastor down in Kentucky somewhere. This is a different church, explained Randy after the early worship service. I barely recognize the place. Randy, a former member of our congregation, left our church in 2001 for an out-of-state job. This was his first visit back in over 3 years. I can't believe the changes, said Randy. The congregation is so much larger, younger, and more alive than it was before. How did it happen? Like many mainline congregations, First United Methodist Church in Lebanon, Tennessee, not Kentucky, peaked in the middle 1960s. Does that sound familiar, some of you folks? Who was here in the middle 1960s? You're going to tell me that was when, who was here? Who was here? Pastor Santorio. Did he fill all these pews? Yes, he did. Was there more spirit then than now? Well, I'm not sure about that. I'm not even going to ask him to say that. But this is not unusual for a mainline congregation. And so, peak in the 1960s. Then, over the next 36 years, the church grew slowly older, smaller, and more internally focused. Did you hear that? Internally focused. The median age of the congregation increased, membership and worship attendance decreased, and the congregation's primary focus shifted to its facilities. We spend all of our time thinking about how we're going to keep the building from falling in on our heads. We're not that congregation. We're different from that congregation. And what I just read to you is only partly true about don't try to become, you know, a totally evangelical Pentecostal congregation overnight. We say amen at the end of the service, but we don't, you know, we don't get too wild. You know, we try to keep a balance so that we appeal to the people that are in the pews. We determine our nation. An atmosphere of grace rather than judgment. Orthodox historical beliefs with an open-minded spirit. A healthy balance between faith of the head and the faith of the heart. Rich diversity. I think we're doing pretty well on number two, but we can do better. We revitalize our worship. We've tried to look at that, and I think we're doing a pretty good job, but maybe other things we need to do.
We emphasize evangelism. The committee meeting is out in church today. Please be aware of it. Evangelism, that scary word that says you have to reach out to the community and embrace everyone and invite them in and make them part of who you are. Evangelism. Oh my Lord, what we try. We connect people to small groups. We don't do a very good job of the chant. We've tried, God knows we've tried, but everyone in this church that's going to be a faithful Christian needs to be in a small group where you pray and study the Bible. Talk to each other about what it is God does in your life. If we're not doing that, we're never going to grow and never be a successful church. Folks, we have a lot of work in that area. We minister to our community. I think we do a fair job in that. We have a lot of mission stuff that reaches out. We make sandwiches. We do other things. We organize for results. That's number seven. I'm going to mention a few of these, and then I'm going to end. Worship God weekly. So we added a simple yet comprehensive four-step process to help members grow as disciples. Did you hear that? So we added a simple yet comprehensive four-step process to help members grow as disciples. I'll be growing together as disciples, members old and new. Do we worship God weekly? Connect to a small group? Serve on a ministry team? Invite and welcome others? Four steps. 4 years, that congregation doubled in size. Praise God. What is your spiritual temperature? Did you test it?